سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا وَزِدْنَا عِلْمًا يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ وَوَفِّقْنَا لِاتِّبَاعِ سُنَّةِ نَبِيِّكَ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ آمين. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enlighten our hearts with the light of His guidance, and we acknowledge we have no understanding except that which He blesses us with. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this gathering of ours and make it a means of attaining beneficial knowledge. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the keys to success in this life and the hereafter, and that is adherence, firm adherence, success in clinging to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ameen and again Ameen. Alhamdulillah, this week, insha'Allah ta'ala, is the last week that we're going to be doing class at this time. Starting next week, we'll be moving to between Maghrib and Isha. Because of the time rapidly changing in the season, then if we continue on this path, we'll have no time for class. As it stands, we have approximately a half of an hour. And I think that suffices for this evening. I don't want to push it, you know, this is good. But that's where we are. So, alhamdulillah, with that being said, I'll start by saying, do you know any of the questions that you have, or do you want to get right to the text?
Neither.
Okay.
Just let it roll, and when we go down for the mic, we turn it off.
You said, and keep it going, and then when we go downstairs, that's when we'll turn it. No problem.
It unnecessary complicates things. And I can always edit that out.
No problem, inshallah.
Yes.
Jail. So we'll go to the text, inshallah.
Please.
Okay. Alhamdulillah. Again, so there's a couple things to mention. We are in the middle of Rabi al-Awwal, which is the month of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is a Mubarak month. It is one of the ideal months to come and get to know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this weekend there were mawalid around the country, really around the world, right? And there's more coming up, and there'll be more even after that. These celebrations of the reverence of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I do think that we need to familiarize ourselves with the stances of those ulama that are followed or said to be followed in our greater community. So for example, Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyah, Ibn Kathir, Ibn Taymiyyah, all three of them and others like them, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali and the like, all of these ulama, they accepted the celebration of the Mawlid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. With Ibn Taymiyyah even mentioning that those who do this intending the ta'adhim, the reverencing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for them is a great reward. Of course, this is a matter of the unseen, and he doesn't have the authority to say that. And yet, my point is that his ruling on it is that it is something that is rewardable to do. And alhamdulillah, we don't do that. But what I wanted to mention is that, meaning that we in this community, we don't have mawalid. And part of it is because we don't have a community. How can you have gatherings of celebration when you don't have people together? And that's just an unfortunate reality. Where is our youth? Where are our middle-aged men? Where are our elders? You know, this is a question that we must ask ourselves, and we must find the answers to. May Allah give us tawfiq. Ameen. What I was saying though about this is that, you know, this weekend past, some of my students, they went to a large Mawlid celebration, and one of the students, they came back and I asked each of them, how was your experience? What did you think of it? You know, did you get a chance to meet any of the ulama, you know, like this? And, you know, each of them had wonderful things to say. One of them said that he got, what one of the things that he got from going there, traveling and sitting in this gathering, was that it gave him the understanding of the need to take as our, how did he put it? He said our, not our essence, our, la ilaha illallah, our, not prototype, our archetype must be adherence to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he felt that, you know, we need to take time to really get to know the Prophet better sallallahu alaihi wasallam, learn his Sunnah and apply it in our lives, and that we have to take the Sunnah as our archetype of being. And I said, alhamdulillah, this is what you learned there. And he said, yes, that was the great takeaway. And so I laughed, because that's my nature. And I asked him, what do you think we're doing? What do you think that we've been talking about week after week after week, you know? And the reality is that, you know, sometimes we need to step out of the mundane and go to some, you know, something extravagant, if you will. Sometimes we need to step away from the drip and drop and puddle and go to the waterfall in order for us to realize that, you know, we're getting water. And this is the problem, is that we are celebrating the Mawlid every single time we come together. We're celebrating the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're celebrating the status of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're reminding ourselves of the seerah and the khasa'is, the special features, the shama'il of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every time we get together. No, we don't do it in an extravagant way, but that's what we are doing, is reminding ourselves of who we are supposed to be. And we are supposed to be a people who envelop ourselves in the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are supposed to be a people who annihilate ourselves in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when we say annihilate ourselves in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what we mean is your likes and dislikes are removed, they're cleansed, they're purified, they are replaced with the likes and dislikes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My favorite color is blue. You learn the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's favorite color is green. My favorite color is green now. I like blue, but my favorite color is green. You find out, you know, I really like frankincense. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's favorite scent was misk. Oh, my favorite scent is misk. I like frankincense, but my favorite is misk. You know, I really like, I don't know, man. Let's say I really like potatoes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved squash. He loved pumpkin. I love pumpkin. Potatoes are cool, but I love pumpkin. And so you replace your preferences with the preferences of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You replace your inclinations with the inclinations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what we mean by annihilate ourselves in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Well, I was taught, I was raised to do it this way every single time. That's, alhamdulillah, your parents raised you very well, but the Sunnah is to do it this way. Okay, I'm going to stop doing what I've done all of my life. For the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years that I've been on this earth, I'm going to stop doing it the way that I used to do it and start doing it the way that I learned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it. That's what we mean by annihilate ourselves in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is what it means to be a Muslim in reality. Not necessarily. So let me go back and say that to be a Muslim is to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and it is to establish the prayer and to pay the zakat if it is upon you, and to fast Ramadan or observe Ramadan in the best of your ability, and to make the Hajj if you're able to do so and you have the means. This is the bare minimum. To treat the halal as the halal and the haram as the haram. However, if you want to be a person of ihsan, if you want to be a person of excellence, if you want to draw near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want to draw yourself more and more to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the love of Allah, to the forgiveness of Allah, then you adhere closer and closer to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the proof of this is قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, if you truly love God, then follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah will love you and forgive you your sins. And so this is who we are supposed to be, a people who we envelop ourselves in the sunnah. But the only way to get there is by drop by drop. You can't, there's no light switch in our lives to where we say, I'm in darkness, I'm going to light. No, it's not like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the day that it blends into the night, and the night that it blends into the day. It's a gradual shift to prepare us. Otherwise, if it was daytime and the sun dropped and the moon rose like in a cartoon, it went from daytime to nighttime, we'd have no time to adjust. And it would be difficult upon us. But rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the change gradual. And the changes in our lives from light to darkness is also gradual. Unfortunately, the changes from from light to darkness is gradual. So some of us don't notice that we're doing it. Some of us don't know that we're going down a spiral path. Some of us don't know that we're going down a slippery slope. Oh, it's just one song. It's just this, you know, it's just one night. It's just, until it's no longer just. I seen a proverb last night. I think it's Tanzanian, and I love it. I think I have to check, but I think it's a Tanzanian proverb. Little by little, a little becomes much. I love that. Little by little, a little becomes much. And that's towards good or towards bad. And so we want to be people who recognize that the light turns to darkness gradually. And so we have to guard ourselves and shield ourselves and protect ourselves at every step. But also know that darkness becomes light gradually. And so we can't do everything all at once. We can't change all at once. But rather we have to make subtle shifts. Slowly implement them, make them habits over time until we become the people that we are supposed to be, the people who our very essence is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And know that the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is nothing other than the Quran itself. I was also asked in a class by some students, what's loftier, what's better, what has a higher position, the Quran or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And this is a difficult question that should never be answered. Why? Because you cannot have the Quran without the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصديا من خشية الله. If this Quran was revealed upon a mountain, the mountain would disintegrate, become annihilated out of awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yet the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could bear it. And so the reality is we could not have the Quran without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what's more is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the context of the Quran, and he is the content of the Quran. It is his seerah, it is his shama'il, it is his khasa'is, his special rank, all throughout the Qur'an. And if we knew the Qur'an, we would get to know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But likewise, we could not have the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam without the Qur'an. Why? Because the Qur'an is his foremost miracle. It is his mu'ajiza. It is that which distinguishes him. And it is the revelation that was given to him so that he is the messenger, the final messenger for all mankind. And so you cannot have one without the other. You cannot understand one without the other. You can't follow one without the other. And so they go hand in hand. At the end of the day, the Quran is it is the divinely revealed, non-created speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we cannot take away from that rank, understanding that it is from the sifat and the af'al of Allah. It is from the attributes and the actions of Allah, in that the Quran itself is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, that is a reality, but understand something, that it is a miracle from the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so having said that, you know, if is the being that receives the miracle greater, or the miracle? The being that receives the greater, the miracle. It's a simple question like this. Is the person who receives $1 million greater, or is the $1 million the person who receives it? The person who receives it. Because they are the one who owns and controls and has license over that. And so in this way, the receiver of the miracle could be said to be greater than the miracle. And yet at the same time, this Quran is from the sifat of Allah. So how can we ever say anything is greater than it? And so rather than saying one is greater than the other, we say no, we don't answer this. They are par and parcel. You cannot have one without the other. They are connected from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until the final hour. And this is our understanding. Why did I mention this? Because the people say, well, what about the Quran, brother? What about the Quran? You're elevating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and you're not speaking about the Quran. Because you cannot have the Quran without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You cannot understand the Quran without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You cannot apply the Quran without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They go hand in hand. And when we understand that, we have proper reverence for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's Muslims who they don't read the Quran except when someone dies, or they don't read the Quran except during Ramadan, or they don't read the Quran except. And the rest of the time they put it on the highest shelf in their house to give it respect, right? But where is the respect for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Where is this all for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They should be treated equally. They should be treated equally. And know, and we remind ourselves first and foremost, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدَكُمْ. None of you truly believes. None of you believes. لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدَكُمْ means none of you believe. It doesn't mean none of you truly believes. It means none of you believe. But we add truly. Or we say none of you have complete faith. We add this word, right? But the Prophet ﷺ said, none of you believe until I am more beloved to him than his parents and his children and all of mankind. None of you truly believes until his heart inclines towards that which I brought. None of you truly believes until I'm more beloved to him than his own self. Right? So our love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our inclination towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is the source, the strengthening, the nourishment of our iman. And so alhamdulillah, when we say Allahumma waffiqna li ittiba'i sunnati nabiyyika Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, oh Allah, give us tawfiq, grant us success in adhering to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are really asking for everything that we claim to be. We're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that love and for that forgiveness and for that, you know, that Islam. Alhamdulillah. And so we mention this just because what are we doing here? The whole purpose of our being here is to know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that we can imitate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that we can follow the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And yes, we are going drop by drop, and that's how I started on this. We are going drop by drop. We are going line by line. We are going one small detail by small detail. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore underwear. What? Why do we need to know that? Well, this is something that when you put on underwear with the intention of adhering to the sunnah, wearing underwear becomes ibadah. It becomes ibadah. It becomes something that is elevated because of your intention. Why? Because innama al-a'malu binniyat. Indeed, actions are booked by intentions. You just put it on like because this is what we do. We just wear underwear. That's just what we do. Then that's the reward that you get, right? You get benefit from it, of course, but that's all you're getting. But when you do it because you know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wore underwear, then you want to be a person who intends to do it for that reason, elevating your mundane everyday action to an act of ibadah, inshallah ta'ala. And so alhamdulillah, this is our introduction to today's class, which we only have about 10 or 15 more minutes for, but we'll make it through, inshallah. Do you have any questions? Any questions?
I'm ecstatic that you expounded on not only the word and its proper usage in the context of Islam, but specifically, as far as I'm concerned, within Tazkiyah, Tasawuf, because I've heard criticism of that, of the usage of that word as being inferring to be ridiculous.
Are you what word? Oh, annihilation.
Yes. And you, the more you expounded on the usage of that word within the context of Islam and of the Tasawuf, the more happier, pleased, and grateful I became, because that's what we're supposed to be doing. There's nothing, everything that I have learned in my years as being a Muslim tells me that's what we should be doing. This, Allah says that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the best example.
Uswatun hasana.
So, where's the, this is what we're supposed to be doing. This is the mindset that we're supposed to be having. And to have someone be, to think otherwise, I'll be nice, was particularly stressful. And this was sheer ecstasy, sheer happiness, sheer great gratitude.
And this is from the problems, is that people, they mistake the ta'adim, the reverencing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the reverencing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with shirk. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I actually, you know, I recently heard someone talking about the misunderstanding of the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned the people not to exaggerate concerning him. And the beauty of that hadith, we stop there, and we often hear it stop there. Don't exaggerate regarding me. But then he went, as the Christians exaggerated regarding Isa alayhi salam. And so none of us, not a single Muslim that I am aware of, thinks that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or a co-creator, or a salvatory grace in and of himself. You know, we want to be careful when we say that, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a means of salvation. The Sunnah is a means of salvation. Love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a means of salvation. What's the dalil for that last comment? Loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a means to enter into the gardens of bliss. Loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a means of entering into the gardens of bliss. What is the jannat? Yani, what is the evidence for this? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. A person will be with those whom he loves. And what is the context of that? The context of that is, a man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the companions asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when is the hour? When? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned it over on him, and he said, what have you prepared for it? He didn't answer him. He answered with a question. What have you prepared for? And I'll pause the narration here just to say that, you know, this is the beauty that this man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when is the hour? And the Prophet, it's as if he said, what does it matter when it is if you didn't get ready? Right? And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what have you prepared for it? And the man responded, he said, I have not prepared for it much prayer, or much fasting, or even much charity. But rather, I love Allah and I love His Messenger. The man said, I didn't do a lot of ibadah. I didn't do a lot of good. I'm not somebody who prays all the time, or fasts all the time, or gives all the time. I'm not somebody who does a lot of good deeds, Ya Rasulullah. But I love Allah and His Messenger. It was in that context that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Al-mar'u ma'a man ahab," that a person will be with those whom he loves. And so, alhamdulillah, the Prophet ﷺ is affirming here that this person who doesn't do a lot will be entered into the garden, will be with him in the garden because of the love. The love is a key. And I'll add that, and I could be mistaken here. So if I'm mistaken, please by all means correct me. But one of the other companions said, "Ya Rasulullah, is it just for him?" And the Prophet ﷺ said, "No, it's for everyone."
The hadith you read from the previous one, preceded this particular talk. I'm looking for the qualification, designation of that hadith.
The hadith that al-mar'u ma'a man ahab, a person will be with them, those who they love.
That's what you just ended
with. Yeah, na'am, but it's also what I started with, so I'm trying to remember. What you're referring
at
to.
At the very least, what is the...
Every narration that I've mentioned tonight is sound. It's authentic. So, you said the verification. That's why I'm saying that.
Is it... Mutawatir? Is it...
No, they're going to be ahead. But, okay. Alhamdulillah. You had a question, Rodney?
Surah
Waqia.
Yes. Well, that surah keeps you out of
poverty. Out of poverty, yes. But that surah, just to be clear, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught whoever reads this surah each day, they will be protected from poverty. From poverty. The reason that I'm saying this is because it doesn't mean that you won't struggle financially. It means that you will not have a sense of poverty. Because there are people who, they recite this surah every day, and they're still strapped for cash. Right? They still don't have money like that. But they don't feel the impact of that poverty. You know, so this is the thing, is that the poverty is a mindset. Poverty is an experience. Poverty is not a reality. And somebody could challenge me and be like, "Well, those starving people, XYZ." I know a brother named Muhammad Ryan. Muhammad Ryan, he's a pacifist. He probably, I can almost guarantee he still is. But anyway, he was a relief worker in Kenya. He was a relief worker in Kenya. Young guy, fresh out of college, went over to Kenya to help people, right? That's what they did. And if I'm not mistaken, he was part of a Christian organization. If not, then it was a UN organization, whatever it was. And they would go and they would treat people, and they would take care of people with AIDS. And he had a woman, a Muslima, who died in his arms. And that led him to Islam. And the reason, when he tells his story, and I haven't talked to him for at least a decade, maybe two decades, but when he told his story, it's because even in that state, she was trusting in Allah. She was happy. She was pleased. She was content. And this is the difference between poverty and what we find through Surah Al-Waqiyah. Through Surah Al-Waqiyah, we find contentment. We find contentment with our situation. And so we have to understand that poverty, even if you don't have anything, even your health, no wealth, no place to live, if you're content with your Lord, you're not in a state of poverty. You're not in a state of poverty. And so we should understand that Waqiyah lifts from us this poverty mindset, this subjective poverty. And not that, you know, if we do this every day that wealth is going to fall from the sky. However, I will say that there is a supplication that you can make, that Imam Ali, may Allah ennoble his face, he said, whoever says La ilaha illallah, al-malik, al-haq, al-mubin, every single day 100 times, they will find their wealth increasing. Al-Kama qala, he said the like of this. And this is the thing about it. First and foremost, he's Ahlul Bayt. Secondly, he is a Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Third, he is a scholar amongst the companions. Fourth of all, he is one of the companions. And so we know that he would never have said anything at all except that he heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would never have made a statement like that except that he learned this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so whoever says La ilaha illallah al-Malik al-Haq al-Mubin 100 times a day, then they will find their rizq increasing, insha'Allah ta'ala, or their provision increasing. And so, alhamdulillah, join al-Waqiyah with this, and alhamdulillah, may Allah enrich you. Ameen. Ameen. Alhamdulillah. So this, you know, going back to what we were saying, you started the conversation by talking about annihilation. And from you mentioning, you know, the people demonizing annihilation, you know, I went into the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is, you know, the key. And so I was saying that he is the way for us to expose ourselves to the garden, and that I was saying that he is a salvatory grace. What I was saying, so initially what we was talking about, alhamdulillah, I'm glad that I did that. So, you know, the thing is that there's not a single Muslim who believes that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is an associate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a partner or an equal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather we all say that he is abad, right? He is Abdullah. He is the abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is a created being. He will have to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be reckoned with the rest of humanity. This is our belief. No Muslim says anything. So when we have this ta'zeem of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this reverence for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no one could ever mistake that for sure. Does it mean that no Muslim makes a mistake when they talk? No, of course not. Muslims are human beings, and so maybe they say something that's like, whoa, you need to tone that down a little bit, right? But at the same time, maybe what they're saying is true and you just don't understand it. And that's one of the problems that, you know, we see, is that people take things and they try, because they're looking for something wrong, and so they take it out of context or they twist it and they try to make accusations. But what I'm going to say is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I know which hadith I started with as well, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I do not fear for my ummah that you will fall into shirk. I don't fear that shaitan will lead you to shirk, but rather what I fear for you is wealth. Right? I fear for you wealth. And so the hadith that I began this discussion with is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that don't exaggerate regarding me, as the Christians exaggerated regarding Isa alayhi salam. And none of us, no Muslim, exaggerates with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam like that. But outside of that, going to that extreme, should we not exalt the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Should we not praise the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And let me ask a question here. Somebody said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all praise is due to Allah. And you're absolutely right, alhamdulillah. But did not Allah name the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Muhammad, Ahmed, Hamid, Mahmud? All four of these names deal with praise. The one who always praises, the one who is always praised, the one who praises creation to Allah, the one who creation praises them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the fact of the matter is that his very name means the one who is praised. Right? So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has a right over us that we praise him. He has a right over him that we have this ta'zeem, this reverence for him. He has a right over us that we love him. He has a right over us that we have the utmost respect for him. right? We don't say, oh, he's just a human just like us. He delivered his message and now he's gone. No, this is wrong to say about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you don't believe me, and I'm saying this not just for your benefit, but for the benefit of the people who hear the recording, if you don't like what I'm saying, understand this and explain this to me. If anything I'm saying is wrong, then explain this to me. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى نَبِيٍّ. Indeed, Allah and His angels send salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what is my saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is worthy of ta'zim, reverence? What is that in comparison to Allah saying that indeed He and His angels, all the angels, send salawat, send praises, send prayers upon, not to. That would be shirk, right? Send prayers upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Oh, you who say that you believe, you too send salawat upon him. Just like Allah and His messenger and His angels send salawat, you too are commanded to send salawat upon him, and the most abundant and qualitative of greetings. Alhamdulillah. So if what I'm saying is wrong, explain to me that I am.
Reverence Muhammad
sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Have ta'adim for him.
Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What you mean by that?
Nah, go on.
Meaning, don't worship him, just send blessings on him.
Yeah, so you should pray for him. You should love him. You should follow him. You should respect him. You should honor him. You should espouse his message. You should call people to his noble character, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of these things we should be shouting from the rooftops, not literally, but we should be shouting from the rooftops that this is the best of creation. There's no created thing, period. Nothing. Not even the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is better than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right? And so we should be people who recognize that he is khayru khalqillah. He is the best of all creation. And so we love him as that. But we don't worship him. We don't pray to him, right? If the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I know people who would argue with this, right? Because people take love to extremes. What I'll say is the Sharia is the chaperone of love, right? But if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in front of me, I would never bow down to him. I would never prostrate to him, right? The reason that people would object to that is because they would say, kiss his feet. I wouldn't mind kissing his feet, right? But I would never prostrate or bow to him. And there's a difference. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves our ibadah. He deserves our love, but he doesn't deserve, only Allah deserves our ibadah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Alhamdulillah.
Thank you.
No problem. And I'll also say, and this is important, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us at du'a, mulk al-ibadah. I'm saying it so that people don't think that I'm saying mulk. I'm not. I'm saying mukh. Yani, the du'a is the marrow. Right? It is the essence. It is the core. It is the reality of ibadah. Du'a is the essence of ibadah. And so I'm saying this to say that we don't ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, allow me to have a child. Ya Rasulullah, help me to get this job. Ya Rasulullah. No, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala receives and responds to our supplications. And so we want to be clear that, you know, we in no way do we worship the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
What about Prophet Abraham?
No prophet. No created being. What do you mean? Wait, let me. I'm saying we don't worship anything but Allah. But
I mean, I'm saying that part.
No.
Completely though, right? We only worship Allah alone. I'm saying that right.
Mm-hmm.
Correctly. But meaning when I mentioned Prophet Abraham, meaning we send blessings on him. Are we supposed to send blessings on him too?
No, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. I know what you mean. Salawat. Alhamdulillah. The end blessings, right? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is important as well. What is the best salawat to send upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? We have books filled with prayers to send upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The best prayer to send upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I don't care. This imam says, "I received a dream, and the reward is this," or "I received this," or whatever they say. Nothing that anyone received is greater than what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught. And the Prophet, I have to stop for the event, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us the Ibrahimiyya. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad. Kama salaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barak ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Oh Allah, send prayers upon Muhammad and the family of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as you sent them upon Ibrahim and his family. Oh Allah, send blessings upon Muhammad and his family, as you sent them upon Ibrahim and his family. And so yes, we do it for the Prophet Ibrahim as well.
So I can send blessings on both. I suppose you send blessings on both of them. Correct, both of them.
And their
family.
No. After the event, we'll continue.
Please provide a definition for the designation of definition of the hadith, its qualifications.
Yeah, inshallah. So after Salatul Maghrib, we're going to pray in 5 minutes. Well, I'll try to get this out in under 5 minutes. So let me say, I'm going to make this very easy, very, very easy. Hadith Ahad is any hadith that is not mutawatir. Alhamdulillah. And so that's the definition, right? So a mutawatir narration is a narration that has enough people in every tabaqat, in every generation, that they could not have come together to agree upon a lie or a mistake, right? And it's sensory, it's not a dream or a vision or an idea, okay? And so enough people in every generation means that it could be two people on two sides of the world, or it can be 500 people in the same town. But it has to be enough people in every generation. They narrate this narration connected in every single generation by so many people that it's inconceivable that they could have ever agreed upon a mistake or a lie. There are only approximately 200 mutawatir narrations. And if a narration is mutawatir, then you must believe in it as you believe in the Quran. Meaning that if you reject it, you, according to the majority of ulama, you are outside the fold of Islam. Alhamdulillah, there are only 200, approximately 200. Also understand that the Quran itself is mutawatir hadith.